Welcome to Community of Love Christian Fellowship, where God loves you and we do too. Join us in person on Sundays from 12:30 to 1:30 p.m. for 60 minutes of dynamic praise, inspiring fellowship, and life-changing worship. Point your GPS to 557 Cambridge Street in the Alston neighborhood of Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. Visit us on the web at colcf.org. That's colcf.org. To learn more about our Friday evening services, our various ministries, and our upcoming special events, now let's join the service already in progress.
Oh, a sign of God's favor. A sign of God's favor. Many times when we pray, many times when we're in the midst of a storm, in the midst of times of challenge, we pray that God would just send us a sign. God, send us a little sign to let us know that you still think of us. Send us a sign to let us know that you're still working on our behalf. Send us a sign to remind us that you are our strength, that you are the power that we need on, that you have never left us nor have you forsaken us. Send us a sign. And so today's prayer, today's sermon, which is a prayer, is a sign of God's favor. I invite you to turn with me to the 86th division of Psalms, Psalm 86. This is a wonderful psalm for you to read, either at home or during the week. If you want to go to the Bible and just spend a little bit of time reading, this is a prayer of David. And we know who David is, but this is one of the prayers, not that he prayed during the midst of any time of challenge or not, but this is what we call a reoccurring prayer. It's almost a prayer very synonymous to what you would pray at mealtime. If you say a little grace before you eat, the recurring prayer, or there's a prayer that you say every night before you go to bed, or there's a prayer that you say when you wake up in the morning, it's a reoccurring prayer. And you say, wow, this is 17 lines long. Yes, this was a reoccurring prayer that David prayed. Although all of it is important, I want to focus our attention today on verses 11 through 17. Psalm 86, verses 11 through 17. Allow me to read it for your hearing. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love towards me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. O God, insolent men have risen up against me. A band of ruthless men seek my life, and they do not set me before them. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant, and save the son of your maidservant. Show me a sign of your favor, that those who hate me may see and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Show me a sign of your favor, that those who hate me may see and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Show a sign of your favor. Just like David, we pray for a sign of God's favor. But David is considered one of the models of faith that we find in his own born desire. He wants to live more and more according to God's will. Even in this passage, we find verse 11, God, teach me. Then we assume that David knows how to be godly. One, the Bible is fluid with David's story. He's seen as one of these great figures of faith. But in his struggle of daily life, we find that even David prays on a daily basis, Lord, teach me your way. And then when we say we honor, glorify, lift up God's name, we find David doing the same thing in verses 12 to 13, where he says, I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, I glorify your name forever. So the things that we say that we ought to do as Christians, we find David modeling them here in this prayer. I mean, in fact, when we find that David says that you have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol, Sheol, for those of you who haven't taken Hebrew 101, amen, is a word that means grave or the pit or the place of the dead. In essence, Sheol is Hades, or the underworld. It's hell. And so here David, even in his prayer,
And I'm giving thanks, God, for your salvation, that you have saved me from having to go to the very depths of hell, even though I am not fully who you call me to be. How do we know that? Because he says, God, teach me your way. Even where I am in my life right now, teach me your way. And then we find me dealing with the realities of a struggling life. A life where on a good day you look to be of faith. But on those challenging days where your vices and those things that have pulled you aside, those things that some may call addictions, those things that some may call sinful ways, those things that we all have, amen, we all have, on those bad days we're challenged. Because the reality is that we don't even like looking at ourselves in the mirror. But the fact is God can see and God cares about us. And our desire to do what David did in verses 14 to 15 is reminding God and saying that there are folks who are rising up against me who are always judging me, who are always trying to gossip about the things that I don't do right. And when I do good, nobody seems to see me. Those folks who are always looking to expose me and exploit the information that they have on me, those folks who seem to always be judgmental, who seem to always be nitpicking, who seem to find every flaw that I have. God, can you hook me up? Can you hook me up? Can you get them off of my back? And then verses 16 and 17, David makes a petition. The first part of his petition is, God, please, can you focus on me? I know that you created the whole universe and all that, and I know that you created the entire galaxy. God, can I have some face time with you? God, I got a little list that I need to reconcile with you right now. Can you point your time with me right now? Can I have your undivided attention? Can I have a little moment with you? And God says, absolutely. Because in that moment, God reminds David that every time that we set aside time to pray to God, God sets aside time to listen and to talk back. Because indeed, prayer is a dialogue, a conversation. Prayer is an opportunity for us to talk face to face with God. And all too often, we get our stuff out. And then we say amen and walk away. And God is still there waiting. And so the next time we come and pray, God is about to open God's mouth, and here we go. And we say amen and walk away again. And so for most of us, God has years of conversation that we've pushed pause on every time God got ready to reveal something to us. And so in our prayer lives, we have to remind ourselves to talk and then listen, to speak and then hear, to conversate in the dialogue. And I know, sometimes it's like, you know, okay, look, shouldn't there be a difference between prayer and meditation? Because when you meditate, you just sit there and you go, That's not what we do. We pray, we're supposed to say, and then God came down to 40 and two generations, and God, who? And the reality is, no, prayer is a conversation dialogue. It can happen in whatever voice, whatever place, whatever space you need it to happen. And the reality is you can't have a conversation dialogue if only one person is talking. And so in the midst of this prayer, David's reminded. So as David says, turn to me and be gracious to me, give your strength to your servant, and save the son of your maidservant. David's invoking the presence of his mama here now. He was like, you hook my mama up. Verse 17, here's where I want to spend the balance of my time. David says, show me a sign of your favor. Because even David realized that God was always speaking. And the question is, are we listening? Are we hearing? Are we doing? And so David says, show me a sign of your favor. This is hard because we can be like many people who overanalyze and walk outside the church and see a blue-breasted bird fly by. And you know, most of the birds that fly by are red-breasted. And so when you see a yellow-breasted, blue-breasted bird, you can say, oh my God, that's a sign from God. Or you can walk down the street and all of a sudden the cloudy skies open up and the sun for 30 seconds peeks through. And we can say, oh my God, that is my sign from God. Or you can go back to your car and on the floor of the car behind the front left wheel, you find a dollar. And you can pray about finances. And you can say, oh, there's a sign from God. Or you can go back home and the phone rings. And it's a telemarketer. But in their script, they say, you will be blessed by. You say, oh, there's a sign. We can overanalyze and hyper and ultra-analyze everything. But the fact is, David says, God, can you send me a public sign? One that not only I will see, but one that my enemies will see, so that they will acknowledge too that I am with you and that you are with me. So here, I got to share with you a revelation, because God hears David. David's asking for a public sign. David's not asking for some mythological or a sign that only he will see. So God reminds David that your ability to speak of the challenges that you're dealing with is a sign. Your ability to acknowledge even the moment that you're in, the trials and chaos and calamities, are a sign. Because like most traumas in our lives, we have a hard time talking about them. We have a hard time talking through them. So God says to David, just your ability to acknowledge that there is something and that you're going through something is a sign that your healing has already begun. The fact that you woke up in the morning and that you have a new 24-hour clock, praise God, to try to get a few things right is a sign that I am with you. The fact that you have supportive friends and family is a sign that I have bestowed upon you loved ones who care enough about you to care about the things that you care about. It's a sign. The fact that you have a loving Christian fellowship of folks who vow to pray for you and to be with you and to laugh when you laugh and cry when you cry is a sign that you are not alone, that you have not been forsaken. The fact that a stranger may walk by and give you a kind word is an opportunity for you to realize that all is not doom and gloom, that indeed there are some good moments even in your catastrophic situations. In life's unexpected turns, God always sends signs to let you know that you are not by yourself. Signs that help you to realize that God cares. Signs that help you realize that God is monitoring and perhaps even managing the situation. They may not always come in the shape of a rainbow. They may not always come in the shape of an envelope. Sometimes they come by the handshake of love, by the hug of someone you haven't seen in a while. Sometimes they come by somebody who you know is being sincere, asking you, how are you doing? Can I help you? Sometimes God's signs of faith come in the morning when your tears stop flowing from your eyes. Sometimes the sign that you're looking for is a sign that you've always known and that you've always had. I love the end of the Wiz, and I probably said this many times before, but this is how much I love it. And the Wiz, not the Wizard of Oz, but the Wiz. Amen. Quincy Jones, kind of, you know how we have Blackened Fish, amen. This is the Blackened Wizard of Oz, amen. Where Diana Ross and Dorothy and Michael Jackson is at the very end of the movie, Dorothy has taken a phenomenal journey, and she's met all kinds of folks in all kinds of shapes and sizes and all kinds of colors. And she had a crew that was rolling with her. And in the crew, everybody had a problem. Somebody needed a brain, and somebody needed a heart, and somebody needed to be oiled. And everybody had a situation. Nobody just needed to get home. And they were told to go find the wizards. Amen. The original story was the Wizard of Oz. But in this story, amen, they were supposed to find the wizards. Amen. And when they got to the wizards, they realized the wizard was a fraud. He was a fraud. some of y'all know like I know, when you ain't got nothing and somebody gives you something, that's the best something you've ever had if your mind is right. Jesus' disciples fed 5,000 men, about 10,000 people, with a couple of little goldfishes and a couple of triscuits. And they were leftovers. When your mind is right, people are doing for you, you realize that it's the hand of God working in your favor. So don't keep looking for God's signs. Realize that you are a sign of God's favor. Not only upon yourself, but to the people who are around. And then we gotta act that way. We gotta love that way. All the confusion and chaos is going around the world. I know people have agendas and platforms, and there's a reason for it. But at the end of the day, can't we just love one another? Can't we just want the best for one another? Can't we just want people to be healed, and people to be successful, and people to be employed, and people to not be hungry, and people not to be impoverished?